Sup team? It's been way too long. It has. And I got my tea today. It's tea day. I like my tea days. Pretty excited about today. Kind of nervous about it, but Blake, sup dude? I'll say this. It's been long enough that whenever I went to put things together in order to get this stream going, I realized that all of the scene stuff that I've got for all the encoder and live stream thing completely fell apart. It was all trash. I'd moved all the stuff around way too many times. So got it done though. Threw it together. Here we are. That's the thing. Like this whole layout, it's like definitely thrown together today. It happens. Are you flying today, Blake? Or just bored? Let me get this set. Okay. Michael Porter, how are you, sir? You're home. What on earth do you do when you're at home? I don't even know what that... Like, what do you do? I know what I do. I split wood. Like, that's split wood and boil sap. That's what I've been doing lately. Oh. Watch YouTube. Well, welcome to YouTube. Good job. No, I have been... life has been nuts the last year or so. We'll talk about this a little bit more as far as, like, what happened and what have I had going on. These things are all out of whack and it's gonna drive me nuts. Where's the thing? There's a thing that like does the adjustment. Oh yeah, you just gotta pull on it. I'm about to go back to school for computer science. Whoa. I feel like there's a whole lot of story there. Whole lots of story there. So yes, I've been running kind of ragged almost the last year. And I feel like there's been some stuff that's like snuck in and discussed on Bookworm. So if you're someone who has kept up with me there, there's a lot you probably already know. But if you haven't, I'm going to do my best to try to catch you up today. So all of that out of the way, I've actually got tons of stuff I want to try to cover today. But basically, what I have been doing is the house remodel. I mean, that's the obvious one. If you've seen anything I've done online, you know that I've been neck deep in house remodel stuff, right? Correct, Blake. Absolutely house stuff. So we tore out two walls in our house, two load-bearing walls, nonetheless, which meant lots of permitting, lots of electrical, because the way that the house is set up, it's built in 1895. The basement is one of the old stone foundation setups, like the old field stone deal where they put mortar and stuff around it in order to create the foundation. Works great. I mean, in our case, it's like 2 feet thick. So it's a pretty substantial foundation. Needs some tuck pointing and such, but it's another topic. But that meant that the walls that sat on top of those, it turns out, those in the kitchen were the two walls that we wanted to take out. So it could be done because the posts would be still sitting over those foundation points. But from an electrical stance, that was the only way to get electrical up to the main floor. Thankfully, there was the other side of the house where we could get it up, but it meant rewiring 2/3 of the house. So I ended up pulling 1,200 feet of electrical cable into the house. Super fun. Lots going on there. So did a lot of that. Redid HVAC for upstairs. Right now, we're in the middle of tearing apart and rebuilding some of the backyard. We have a pretty substantial garden that we're working on expanding. All this to say, like, I've got a lot going on housewise, and that's where I've been spending tons and tons of time. And ultimately what happened was we closed on the house. I knew that a lot of my online stuff was going to have to take a back seat for a while, but I ended up putting it on the back seat before I really talked about it online. So that's on me, not communicating that with you guys very well. I will absolutely take the brunt of that mistake. But that said, I think what we're going to talk about today will help with some of that. Some of what I've been doing, if you've noticed, I have been doing a few things online in the last month. Anybody caught up on all this? Let me show you some of this. Obviously, there are a lot of things I've been doing. Let's see if I can get all the buttons to work correctly here. Hey, it still works. Magic! So let's go to the first one here. Welcome to Obsidian. I think at this point people know kind of what I've been doing in Obsidian, maybe somewhat. If we go here. So if you've seen this, this is an article I wrote for the Suite Setup. And there's a lot here, but I kind of detail, I shouldn't say detail. There's a lot of information here about kind of how I ran that house remodel from a task and project management stance. And this kind of forced me, yeah, like what you're saying, Blake, it kind of forced me away from the bullet journal. And it was because I needed to keep the collaboration piece there, mostly with my wife. Anyway, there's a lot here. Go read that if you want. Let me grab, I hate that thing. Hate it. Can I put this in here? Will it let me do this? It will, magic. So that article is one that I wrote for them. I had started writing it before I got connected to post it on their website. I'll talk more about that here in a bit. But this one is one that I spent a lot of time on this. How do you manage chaos? I talked to somebody who works in commercial construction, commercial building processes, and explained to him basically everything that I was doing to the house. And he told me that was a 9 to 12 month project, and we did it in 3.5. So it's kind of intense what we went through in that 3.5 months. So anyway, this is one that I've recently kicked out. Another one, let me get back here. This one's kind of a fun one too. I've been getting into Bunch. If you know the tool Bunch, it's pretty slick. But this is an article I put together on how I'm using it kind of for communication mostly. It's slick in that it lets me select a thing. Actually, we're here on this computer. I can hit this up here. I'm not going to do it right now because it'll close. I wouldn't be able to see what you're saying. But I can click on that and it will show me or pull up all of those programs. But then I can run commands in it. Of course you did, Michael. And I can basically do anything I want and set entire modes for the computer, which is kind of blowing my mind a little bit. And the more time I spend with it, the more I'm like, holy cow, why did I not? I think Michael, you knew this. You knew I was going to get deep into this. Of course you did. So anyway, that's another one I've been doing. Here's one that's kind of fun. In that this one has a video with it. You can actually see it on this YouTube channel. But I put together this Alfred workflow that lets me, actually, let's go here. It lets me create projects in both Obsidian and my local file directories, folders, and then keep those two linked to each other. I suppose I can show you this. So if I go to, let me go here. This is one I created, so I know there's like nothing here. If I go to the preview of this, this particular project file, it lets me create this support folder link. If I click on that, it will pull up that folder. But then from that, you'll notice I've got a notes URL. I can double click that and it'll open up this file. So anyway, it's pretty cool. That's kind of my latest experiment in scripting and such. And then obviously one of my latest Bookworm episodes is up here. Bookworm, I've kind of been good about staying on with it. It's been tough to keep my reading habit in check. That one's been a challenge. It's not coffee, by the way, if you're just now joining. That is tea. So anyway, I have lots of thoughts that I want to walk through with you today to kind of explain what I'm saying in this tweet of the biggest change I've ever made online, what I've been up to over the last year. So over the last year, let's start there. I suppose we can go back here. Over the last year, I have been, obviously the house remodel. That's been a big thing. But I don't want to pin everything on that because I'm not neck deep in building house stuff yet, right? Like at this point, I mean, I've got a lot of that on the back burner, backed off quite a bit, took the foot off the pedal a little bit. But I've also been working with my wife to start a new business. We affectionately call that Acorn Ridge, which is what we've named the property that we purchased. So there's acornridge.co, which is the website for that. It's like cooking classes and leather craft and stuff. So it's a very different thing than what you've normally seen me do. And I'm not really the one making anything for it. That's my wife's endeavor. So that's been something I've been very involved with, especially from a web building stance. That's been a big part of what I've been doing too. But also, my job got a lot bigger, the day job. cooking is very analog. Nice call. The things that I have been doing at work have expanded massively. And I don't know what this is or what has led to it, but I know that I have been asked to do a lot more from a leadership stance than I have been previously. But I've also been asked to expand the amount of content production that we're doing from a technical stance for the church. And that has meant increasing the hours that my assistant's working, the number of events that I'm setting up and designing for. There's just a lot going on. My teams have gotten bigger. So there's tons, and it's required a lot of headspace that I haven't. I've had to do lots more thinking for work, and it hasn't allowed me to have the clarity of mind in order to do anything for you. And I get that. It's forced me to step back as a result. However, right now, I've been in the midst of, hi Carol, I've been in the midst of obviously some of these walks that I do morning and evening on our property through the trails, scaring off the loons and the deer that are hanging out in the woods. So I've been doing a lot of that. And in the process of doing those walks and getting that time, it's allowed me to really start to process what it is that I've got with my online presence. And it's occurred to me that I don't do hardly anything for it right now. And there are quite a few things that are in existence that don't mesh well. And I have spent maybe the last month and a half, every time I've gone on a walk, this has been the topic of thought during those periods, twice a day, every day, for the last almost 2 months, month and a half, somewhere in there. You combine that with the books we've been doing for Bookworm, and it brings me to some really interesting places. I have had a conversation with Mike about some of this, as well as a couple other folks, one of which is also an online creator, the other is not, to try to get some perspective, okay, on what my thoughts are around what I'm doing. So there's really four different thought patterns, thoughts that I've been, you know, thinking patterns, I guess, that I've been working my way through. And they're, each of them is leading me to big changes for what I want to do online and the way that I operate online. Okay. The first of which is building consistency. If you followed me for more than about 3.2 seconds, you know that I have this pattern. I will do a lot of things online. I will start webinars, start a whole new membership site, build a course, release it, get tired, and disappear for a few months. And then I will come back and we'll have some grand idea, like we're talking about today. I will go through the process of building it up, get it going, feel like it's on its way, get bored, and disappear for a while. I have done this for years, and it's kind of annoying even to me. So I'm aware of this. I am frustrated by this, and I'm sure it frustrates you as well. That's my take, okay? Not really a hot take. So I tend to come and go. So I'm working on my path, ADHD life cycle. It's so true, so true. Get a grand idea, run with it full speed, throw it in the trash and start over. Basically the way it goes. Yep. Now, the problem with that, though, is when you have an online presence like what I've built, it leads me to a place where you have a lot of things happening, and it's easy to lose track of what's happening when and where. And because of that, you get spread thin very quickly, and it gets hard to keep track of it and what you should be doing when. Okay, so this consistency piece is one that I'm working on quite hard and have been working through what the patterns and cycles are for about 3 months now. What are these repetitive routines that I can put in place in order to help me build this consistency and make it a long-term play? Okay, that's ultimately what I've been working through mentally. So building that consistency is a very strong component of this. And in order to do that, I know that I can't have too many irons in the fire. I have to pare it down significantly and nail down what it is that I'm going to do, right? Which brings me to the second point that I've been working towards. Can you make a guess? I've been focusing more on, well, so much of what I do online involves like the productivity space, right? I say that all the time. I just made that camera go out of focus. I have a tendency to do one of two things. Either I build something very, very simple, very, very repetitive. I tend to do that. Or I build something crazy complex. And what I've learned, if you go read the article that's in the chat up above, building things that are simpler are significantly better for me, because then I can skip past, well, whenever I make it complicated, when I do these big grand ideas, even when I've on the surface tried to make it simple. Like take for example, the OmniFocus dashboard, right? that was a concept that I pushed for a long, long time, because the beauty of that was it was simple, right? Just one place to go, one place to get that information for what I'm going to do today, right? And you can kind of see this even with things like Obsidian. People often want to build a dashboard note, if you will. And I have a note here. We're here. Let me show you. This is a note that I maintain that I call zero. I'm not a huge fan of the term map of content, but I will use the term maps, which you can see here. If I make this actually viewable, this is what that looks like. This is very basic. And there's nothing grandiose about this. It just gets me to different places in my Obsidian vault here, my task, my text notes. So I have started working my way towards more of these simple views, but like the milk only cows. Yeah. So I know that things like the OmniFocus dashboard appear simple, but if you look at what it takes to put things into that, it is significantly complicated. Right? And codes, you guys. So the OmniFocus dashboard required the setting up of a perspective. It required a certain structure of projects and contexts, and it required to, coaches. You guys are killing me. Like and subscribe. Since we're in distracted mode. With those things happening in so many different areas inside OmniFocus, it was easily complicated behind the scenes. It took a lot to maintain that, right? And that's what I don't like. I've realized that I have spent a lot of time building these systems and these structures so that it is simple on the front, and yet it is more complicated in the back, on the back end, right? And that's okay for some people. I'm just not one of them. I was simply doing these things to make it MOC, I like it, to make it appear easy to use, even though it was so fiddly and required so much work that I spent more time managing the system than I did working the system. Like, people talk about that all the time, right? But I didn't think I was doing that, even though I'm someone who benefits from more of the simple. So I've been processing this simple, see ya Blake, this more of not Blake, Craig. You're taking off, Craig? That's what it is. Sorry. Saw a plane, and I know Blake flies, but now I'm just realizing, connecting dots. Sorry about that. Bye, Craig. Thanks for joining us. The beauty of these simple systems, I think, comes from some of the push for this non-proprietary view, this app agnostic view. Like, that's kind of what I'm working my way towards and have been slowly pushing a little bit. So trying not to get locked in. I do that a lot now, right? Thanks, Michael. This is something that I think I'm wanting to focus more on. You know, I have this tagline on my site, an analog mind in a digital world. And I think I need to embrace that to its true form. I have regularly tried to pigeonhole into one side or the other, but I think I really need to take on that hybrid view. And that's okay. But I think that hybrid view lets me lock in on this non-proprietary, easily fluid, movable systems mentality, but maintaining the simplicity of it so that I don't need to spend lots of time fussing with it. Make sense? Anyway, that's thought number two. So the consistency piece, the simple non-proprietary piece. And then third, I've spent a lot of time thinking about how do online creators earn an income? This one hurts a little bit because the standard, the modus operandi is to do a couple different things. Namely, the big one right now is subscriptions or memberships. Setting up subscriptions or memberships and then offering premium content or extra content for people who are on those subscriptions. And I'm aware that I'm speaking to people who have paid me these subscriptions in the past. And this is something that I'm aware that everyone recommends this whenever people go it alone or go indie. Like, this is one of the first things they stand up is a membership system. It's not necessarily bad, but if you've caught the news with like the Netflix thing recently of them having subscriptions drop, there's a lot of reasons for that. But I think that, well, let me just say this. I don't do these. I don't subscribe to creators at all. I will subscribe for value add services. I have a subscription for Apple Music. I have a subscription for, I don't even know what. I used to have one with Dollar Shave Club, but they upped their shipping rates, so I just figured I'd buy their stuff in store instead. So, because I can do that now. But I don't have subscriptions. I don't have much for memberships outside of like software. It doesn't really exist for me. So that is something that I know I have struggled to commit to. I just realized the chat thing was looking at me weird. So I don't use these. And if I don't use them, why am I offering them? And if I'm saying that out loud, it kind of hurts a little bit knowing that that is a core source of income that does work, at least in the short term. Okay. So that's number three, subscriptions and memberships. Following that path of finances, video courses. I have made a significant amount of money off of video courses in the past. However, it is always, 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 always front-loaded. And it is always a struggle to figure out how to help people actually go through them. I put out a tweet about this on the Twitter, the soon-to-be Elon Musk Twitter. It is something that I know a lot of people will purchase, but it seems like very few people actually go through. Right? So, if that's all the case, people don't go through video courses, what do they actually do? They go through the cohorts, or they buy the things and don't run through them. Steven, I don't think it's wrong. I don't. I just know that I personally don't do it. Something like Bookworm feels a little different to me for some reason. And I think it's because there's more than just more content. Like there's access to some files and stuff. I guess you could argue that that is content. Well, here. This is why. Sometimes, and this is part of my angst with it, I think. When I have done this membership subscription process, whenever I post something to that membership, right? My tendency as a creator is to want people to want it. My desire is for people who are not a part of that membership to want it as well, so that they would purchase the subscription and join the subscription. Okay? You with me? When I'm doing that, it means that the feeds that are normally full of free stuff now have sometimes not free stuff in them. Right? So that means that whenever I see something from Joe Buehlig on the Joe Buehlig RSS feed, some of it I can click on and get to. Some of it's not. Right? Because some of it's behind that paywall. And when it's behind the paywall, and I don't make it clear up front which is which, even if you do make it clear up front, it's kind of the whole missing out thing, the fear of missing out. Like, it's playing off of that. And it feels icky to me. I don't like it. I really don't like it whenever I see those feeds from other people. We don't do that with Bookworm at all. There is no place that we will push you to seeing what is going on behind that paywall at all. It doesn't exist. Now, you can get to it, and there are links to it from places. We'll talk about it, and we'll talk about what's behind it, but it's a very short segment, and you won't get hints as to what's in there unless you are a part of it. Do you get what I'm saying? Like, it's not a... When you subscribe to that Bookworm feed, 100% of that is free. There isn't anything in that feed that is behind a paywall. Right? I think that's some of my reluctance, to use your word, Steven. Welcome back, Carol. I struggle with it. I really do. Whenever there's the flooding of paid stuff inside the free feeds. Now, obviously, the clean answer here is, well, don't do that. Right? I could maintain the membership and just not do that, right? But again, I don't use those. Okay? The video course thing, same thing. I don't buy them. I have access to quite a few of these. And even when they're given to me, I tend to not go through these. Advertising promotion introduces a lot of risk to creator materials. Yes, that's a good way to put it. There is a lot of risk to that. And I kind of get tired of trying to manage that risk. Because from a creator stance, it's not simple to decide what you're going to put where and how you're going to message for it. Am I constantly trying to push the things that are behind the paywall? What's the balance of pushing the free stuff versus pushing the paid stuff? Like, it gets to be draining and difficult, and I'm kind of tired of it. Okay. Video courses are the same way. Like, I feel like I'm constantly pushing something that I want you to buy, and I think there are better ways. I think that's what I'm coming to. There are definitely ways to do those things well. I can't say that I've ever bought into them when they're done well. And I just don't use them at all. That's what it is. So the question is, if that's the case, why am I doing it? And that brings me to some of like the decision-making process I've been going through lately. Which is kind of the scary part of this, okay? So, all of this said, and this has been something, I made these decisions approaching 3 weeks ago now, 2 weeks ago now, and have been hesitant to say or do anything about it because I've been trying to figure out how wrong I am, and yet, as things go on, I realize that this is absolutely the right move I need to make, okay? So bear with me. Okay. So three things need to happen. Number one, these are the decision-making things here. I need to simplify the branding that I manage online. Okay. With the ADHD approach, getting the new ideas and pushing things out, I have things in a lot of different places. There is the big one where I've not named, I guess, is the Analog Joe piece. Okay. So I have joebuehlig.com. There is analogjoe.com. There is discourse.joebuehlig.com. There is learn.joebuehlig.com. these things are all over the place, right? Things exist in a lot of different places. I'm dropping Analog Joe as it stands. So analogjoe.com will, as I get things done, redirect to a blog post I'm in the middle of writing that will explain that particular drop, okay? No Beulig Yule logs? No. Nope. So Analog Joe is going to go away, which by proxy means that the subscription cycle that is there will drop as well. So also have an email going to anyone who's currently on the subscriber list there, that whole list, explaining the drop and those subscriptions that I think there's some that are still outstanding will get canceled. Okay. So that is in motion right now. Okay. Yeah. Tell me about it. I'm like scared out of my mind right now. Thanks, Steven. So those subscriptions are going to disappear. AnalogJoe.com disappears. The learn.joebulig.com disappears. That is actually sitting on top of Podia is where that sits. This is kind of the second piece here, but I'm going to jump back and forth. So simplifying my branding, it's all going to come down to joebulig.com. Everything else disappears, right? So joebulig.com is where things live. That's going to force me into dropping courses and the subscriptions. Both of those disappear. Now, when I say disappear, the live stuff and the webinar stuff that was through analogjoe.com, it's going to continue to happen just in the mix of things that I do, like what we're doing here today. Completely open and free. The video courses that live on Podia right now, the learn.joebulig.com, they're going to come live here on YouTube. Those will become playlists, completely open and free. And those I will start releasing, I think it's tonight, is when those will start releasing daily. I'll have a video that's being released for like the working with OmniFocus stuff primarily. That will all go free starting tonight. And it'll have a process that's going to queue those up and release them. So the subscriptions go away. The video courses go away. AnalogJoe.com goes away. Learn.JoeBulig.com goes away. Discourse.JoeBulig.com goes away. Discourse is the forum that I have behind the scenes of JoeBulig.com that runs all the commenting that's there. And honestly, I pay every month for it and it gets like no use outside of people trying to get support or something from me, which I get because I'm not exactly good at responding to emails and such. So there's that. So that one needs to drop as well because it's just not in use because this is some of the publicity play, right? So if I make everything go free the way that I'm talking, the obvious question is, well, how do you support that, right? I did drop the analog watch because it broke. So I got the digital now. If I can get it fixed, I'll put it back on. So all of that stuff goes free. How do you make an income off of that? And the short answer is that in the short term, you don't. But there's a few things at play here. One is that as I'm able to simplify and shrink what I'm doing, it means that I'll actually do something, right? Part of the reason that I haven't been doing anything on joebulig.com or anything on analogjoe.com is because it's too much. I cannot manage both of those brands at the same time in the way that I want to run them. So they need to consolidate down to one, right? So because it all consolidates down to one, and I'll explain kind of my intentions on what I'm working towards content wise, but because I'm able to shrink that, I can actually start doing something. And I'll step into like the affiliate marketing piece, only using the tools that I love. That's like the thing for me. Like, if you have an affiliate program, that's great. But unless I am absolutely in love with your product, I'm not using your affiliate link. Like, if you see an affiliate link from me, you know it's a tool that I'm head over heels for. That's the way it works. So I'm going to step into that. I'm not a fan of the ad world, but sponsorships and ads are definitely the way that this works, right? You're not going to see my site load up with ads all over the place. You're probably going to see one. I've got the whole carbon ads thing. I think they got a different name now, but I've got that whole thing, like the good ones that don't do all the crazy weird tracking. So that I'll drop in whenever I've got the time. And between that and we are exploring like sponsorships and such for Bookworm, I don't know when we'll get to that point. I know that the show is large enough that we can do that. And on top of that, as I'm able to build things out and do some of the video work that I'm shooting for, the YouTube piece can chip in over time as well. That's the current thought process and the plan. And I'll admit it's kind of scary to consider that from a financial stance. So the two of the three that we've talked about here, these decisions that I'm working for, simplifying the branding, everything down to jobylug.com, the product changes, video courses and everything going free. I guess the discourse piece I kind of briefed over. The reason I'm dropping that is because it forces the conversation around the articles to happen in social media, which I'm totally on board with. One thing that I have that I've not really talked a whole lot about is that if you go to jobylug.com/microblog, that's where I tweet from, which is a bit weird for people. But it also posts to Mastodon and micro.blog. It will post there as well. So if you reply to any of those, it ends up showing up on my site. I have a weird web mention thing that's going on, and we'll let that all aggregate and pull down. Don't do speeded up text. Oh, you didn't let me see that. Patreon, I feel like, is the same as the membership stuff. It's similar to like using Memberful for something. So there's that. To me, it acts the same. So those two pieces. The third one means that in order for the affiliate piece, the ad and sponsorship piece goes, like in order for that to work, my reach needs to get bigger, right? I need to up my game a little bit, and the consistency piece will certainly help with this. But there's two things happening. One is when I've got some time, which I know is coming up, I'm starting to put out feelers to do a little bit more guest podcasting. So that's a thing that I'm working towards. The other one that I've been working on already and that I'm in the middle of that is going to handle the interim, at least, I don't know how long the interim is, a year maybe longer, is I am now an official contributor for the Suite Setup. So thus the articles that I have put out for the Suite Setup. That's where that comes in. Definitely a paid gig there as well. My voice did something weird there. If I'm speaking ads, don't speed it up. Is that what you're saying? Don't do advertising with my voice that we cannot imagine you ever using. Yes. Yeah, that's actually the hard part with like the Bookworm thing that we've talked about, the ads that come with that. The question is, how do we make sure that those are for things that we would actually encourage people to use? So that's a tough one, actually. It's harder than you'd think to make that happen. But that's the committed thought pattern that we're working towards on that one. And I'm doing the same Like, I will say there are two different companies that I have talked to in the last 9 months about sponsorships. Obviously, they don't want to do that until I've been consistently producing anything online. And because in one case, I told them flat no. And in the other case, it's questionable. And it's because those are products that I have used and I have written about, but they're dicey for my use right now. And I am not a heavy user of them for a variety of reasons I'm not going to go into today. Maybe another time. But because of that, they will not be a sponsor of myself. So it's questionable. Considering what others have done of subscription means no ads. So if you're on subscription, you get no ads. I get it, but it's a whole thing to manage. And again, it's the whole what's where. So all of that, so if we back up and repeat here, I've been working through like, how do I build consistency? I am focusing more on like simple and non-proprietary systems, avoiding subscriptions and video courses, right? So I'm simplifying everything down to joebulig.com. Everything goes free, goes onto YouTube, doing some guest podcasting and the contributor thing at the Sweet Setup. What does that mean for the types of content I'm creating and how often that's happening? Let me give you the goal here. And once I have that goal pitch, like that's what I'm working towards. That will not happen right away. And I know that because work stuff has not settled down yet. But there are essentially five different types of content that people will create. And those are newsletters, articles, videos, live streams, and video courses, right? So those are the kind of the five that you typically see, unless I've, well, podcasts, six. So those six are ultimately what are at play here, right? I will get to doing a weekly newsletter. I've got a few that I'm in the middle of working on, renaming that from Weekly Impulse to Weekly Curation. Basically, I've been trying to work through what does it look like for me to collect some high quality tools, products, services, links for the week. Not sure how many that will equate to, but something along those lines. I've always enjoyed the articles that have, or the newsletters that just have a ton of best of sorts of things. And I seem to be pretty good about finding things like that. So I'd like to put something like that together on a weekly basis. It's kind of fun. Articles that I'm writing. There's a lot of this that's going to happen on the Sweet Setup initially, but I know that there's a lot of things that I do and have thoughts about that don't fit the Sweet Setup's topic. Obviously, some of the topics that I'm exploring and will write about are the analog and digital systems and tools, simple or not. But the two that are kind of floating out there that will come with that along for the ride, analog life versus digital life is what I've been terming this. How do my real world relationships differ from my digital relationships? Like, obviously the relationship you and I have are digital. Like, I don't see most of you in person ever. So it's definitely a digital relationship. How do those differ in so many ways? So talking about those two different realms, analog life versus digital life. And then something I've done this for a long time, but have never talked about it per se, but like brain training. How do I go through the process of teaching myself to do different things, right? And that's probably going to cover a lot of different territories. So those are kind of the topic areas for that. The video stuff I'm going to do, and articles I'd like to get to about once a week. Videos are the same, but those are likely going to end up being like demos of the different tools and systems and such. I kind of want to see where that one goes. I'm not sure what the video realm is going to include, at least up front. Okay. The podcast, obviously that one's Bookworm for me. That's just going to sit right where it's at every other week. Nothing's going to change there, outside of, you know, some of the monetary methods that we have there. We'll see. See what happens. Courses, the ones I have are coming to YouTube, like I said. The goal is to get the first one up tonight. I've got some time tonight later on, when I'm planning to get the first one of those out. And I don't know that I'm doing much for courses beyond that, because I feel like so much of like the teaching and the series teaching like that, I don't think it fits. I feel like I haven't been able to consolidate it and synthesize it well enough if it takes more than one, unless it's a pretty complicated process. In that case, it's probably a series of videos on YouTube instead of a course. So that is probably not something I'm going to do at all, unless it's a paid gig in some form. Live streams, though, the last one here. Obviously, this is one of those. My goal is to start doing these weekly again, and I can do that right away. So that one we will be jumping into immediately. We will have another one next week. And there's really two different types of streams I'm looking at running here, possibly a third. But what we'll do next week and what I want to explore is the concept of thinking time. And this is really going to be a, honestly, it's a process of how do you build notes? Obviously the Obsidian PKM world is on fire. I'm not trying to play into that. I just know that I have not much for time to sit and make notes like that, but I do spend time in Obsidian doing a lot of that sort of thing. I feel like I should do it live on stream with you, and then you can see kind of how I'm doing things. Maybe we can figure out some ways of doing it. A lot of times that ends up devolving into setting up templates for different things and writing scripts that do different things. So like that sort of thing. And I feel like it could be helpful just to see a system and see how it works. On fire. You still need to start it. So there's at least a start there. The other one, I just want to do some guest shows. I feel like I could have a lot of fun myself, and you included, just seeing how other people do things or just talking about different things, finding someone who's done something interesting and bring them on to the stream and see how they're doing it. Have them show us around, that sort of thing. So I would like to do that. It's also possible, I played around with this at one point, of doing like video call-ins. Blake might need to be honest. I'm not sure that I would give him an out. Force his hand. It's possible to do like a office hours queue and do it by video and have people jump on and join me. And that might be kind of fun. We'll see. I feel like we need to grow a little bit more first, because you'd have to have 10, 15 different people in the queue for that to work well. So that one may take some time. Not to say that you guys aren't amazing and wouldn't do that, but we'd have to have a fairly large viewership in order for that one to work out. Buy a good webcam. Yes, always. I hear lots of good things about the Elgato face cam. I actually have a fancy cam at this point, since it sits around most of the time. That's a Sony Alpha 6400. Thus, it does like the blur stuff in the background and such. You did offer to talk about checklists. I feel like we should do that. So I got to get some stuff rolling time-wise and such with that, but we'll get there. And I think that it could be a good process. There you go. You guys still with me? The reason I call this stream, because I'm realizing now, like, if you see the title of this, it's kind of like, wait, what? The analog digital productivity clash. Really, what has happened here, if you think about, like, this whole thing from a top down view, I had anything analog was on analogjoe.com, anything digital was on joebuehlig.com. And because those two were kind of fighting for my time and attention, it meant that neither of them happened. And I couldn't keep either one stood up. Which is frustrating to me. What do you do? Pivot. Make a change. Per Mike's recent newsletter. Okay, what did I get wrong, guys? You think I'm crazy? Surely I'm crazy. I know that at some point, and maybe this is what we need to do next week, because I got to go here shortly. I'm going to have to keep these to like 1 hour. But I think that probably what we need to do is just a flat out Obsidian tour next time, because if we're going to do like some thinking time deals, like, you're going to have to know kind of how I run the tool. Obviously, like, if you look at this, like, I run a pretty clean setup of Obsidian. There's not a lot going on with it, but we'll see. I'll show you around, show you how I've got it set up next time. Thanks for the thoughts there, Blake. So anyway, I hope that this up here gets to be kind of fun, like doing some of the thinking stuff. Because I feel like there's a lot of stuff that I do in Obsidian that's a little bit weird and a little different. So we'll see. I feel like the tour would help understand a lot of stuff a little better. Okay. I gotta run. Appreciate everyone sticking around today, listening to my crazy ideas. But ultimately, I think this is, if you catch the undertones here, what I'm saying is that I want to make a run at the online thing. And I've kind of flirted with it for years. And you've been gracious enough to go on that ride with me. But if it's going to succeed, and I need to basically decide, am I going to do this as a long-term thing or a not? And if the answer is yes, then I need to actually focus on it correctly and not have it be so scattered. That's my intent. That's the goal. So anyway, thanks for listening today. Appreciate the thoughts there, Stephen and Blake. So pay attention to emails for tonight. I guess it wouldn't be an email tonight. But if you are on some of that membership stuff or product stuff, you'll see some emails coming out probably over the next week as those technicalities and tactical pieces are put in place. So that is the goal and the intent. So catch me next week. We'll do an Obsidian tour and we'll get this party rolling. All right. Thanks, team. Catch you next time.